Thank you, Professor Lee. Actually, I'm collaborating with Professor Lee and Song for the Global Carbon Projects. I'm from NIS, and I'm head of the Yoshiki International Office and the Korea Office, Korea University, and also Yoshiki Office. We have been collaborating already a long time, and also working for the Future Earth in collaboration with NASA. And today I'd like to explain a little bit about our recent papers and including some of the data sets. And yesterday I talked with Professor Lee about asking him why do you want the GCP office and working with NASA, and he said that for the internationalization of the students, to give more opportunity for the students to work with international. So it's a really nice idea, so I'd like to invite your students, also if some of you are students interested in this topic, I'm happy to support your stay at this. And I can skip some of the slides because Florian beautifully explained. I have a little bit of background, well, we need to explain this, but we are trying to achieve this 2-degree target, or 1.5-degree target of the Paris Agreement. We have no time to study for the next decades details, but we need to think about how to implement this, in fact. And this is a paper that Pete Smith and some emails and everybody and GCP colleagues are looking at how this X as a negative emission technology really achieved as a crop or forest or CDR. And this is an area requirement for this negative emission technology. This simply shows that the huge impact to the land. And we decided to assess how much land impact is arising from this BECCS and other technologies. And for achieving BECCS, this is a little bit oversimplified assumption that this contrast with switch grass like this will be grown to sequester carbon by the end of this century per year, 3.3 gigaton equivalent carbon. And the land requirement for this and energy requirement for this is so huge. And we need rapidly to increase this effects according to the AR5 PCC scenario. It's not my recommendation, but really, in Japan, we have Olympic Games in 2020. After the Olympic Games, we need to immediately jumpstart this X. This is a PCC scenario. And so for that purpose, we need to use this a lot of increased agricultural land to plant bioenergy production. So this is an area where the bio-ops can be grown in the year of the currently existing soils. So this is assumptions. So here is assumptions of this IPCC for BECCS. So by the end of this century, 2 billion hectares of agricultural land is assumed to exist. The current assumption is this bio crop production use almost one-fourth of this total agricultural land. So this is really a big question. Is this really sustainable or not? We can produce enough food to support the whole population of the world. So some people say this is a really problem for the food security. I don't go into the detail of this assessment. Instead, I try to assess the other assumptions. Try to reduce this necessary land to half by irrigating the bio crops. And another assumption is to reduce the area half by making use of more forest land. Maybe Florian will get angry with this assumptions, but I'm not saying destroy the forest, but use some forest in the system for water. And actually, a huge area already used for palm oil plantation. So I'm not endorsing any of these scenarios, but just simply trying to assess another scenario. So assessing this scenario, we used our project team members, Hanazaki-san. He's a famous hydrology model. And that's also using this model. And this model assumed that land surface model detect human activities 0.5 degree day intervals, and crop growth submodel spot based, and the water abstraction submodel, by constraining water availability, like crop growth, don't be strong, and environmental flow, and lattices. And using this model, we have assessed this S1 scenario and S2 scenario. And cropping period is the same that the days and temperature. The temperature is larger, higher than the base temperature for crop growth. The maximum 300 days crop growing period. And the irrigation assumption is that keep soil moisture above 75% of soil wetness index. Assuming the operations. Water constraint. This is very strong constraint. That if river water is depleted, irrigation water is supplied from unlimited imaginary water resources. We didn't constrain the water they supply to the water from the river. So if you have underground water, this is possible. But in many cases, may not be available. But this is assumption we did this case, this one scenario assessment. This is a crop growth submodel. This is a yield of the crop, bad crops. And this is growing depth. And simulate the daily loss of miscanthus and switchgrass. And estimate growing period and estimate daily assumption accumulation of biomass and yield. And then, as I mentioned, this estimated irrigation water requirements satisfy this crop period. And abstract water from river to meet the water required. Draw water from the river. And if depleted, assume that this water is supplied from somewhere else. Irrigation water requirement is this thing. And then the results show that the best case scenario is a current situation. Total crop land is this much, and this is a S1 scenario, this is the main fed. Number is opposite as well from the previous slides. But this is irrigation scenario to make the area half. And then the bioenergy cropland is half, but water demand is high. Some of the benefit fed cropland is converted to irrigated energy, bioenergy crop. This is assumption. And this is a result. So this irrigation per year cubic kilometers, food energy demand for S2, this is irrigation. So it's a huge irrigation water demand appears here. And this is a river and river water demand. So this is a current river irrigation demand. So this means that this irrigation demand from the rivers is doubled, and then the river irrigation demand even higher. So this finding from this one simulation is that 250 MHz of bioenergy irrigation increases water requirement by 130%. Abstraction from the river is less than 50% only. Irrigation increases bioenergy crop yield by 40%. So yield is increased because you supply more water, crop grow first, and grow. And the problem with this scenario of irrigation is too much dependency on non-river irrigation. So in fact, this is unsustainable. And so this might conflict with drinking water or some other, you know, industry water, or even creating energy in the midst of continuous conflict with these other scenarios. And so this is a total water abstraction for 1 year back. And this is irrigation water food production, change person. So this area will be impacted if this scenario is being implemented. So this is a withdrawal to water availability scenario WWA ratio. This is a kind of index to show how much this water subtraction is high water stress. If WWA is more than 0.4, which is this yellow or red, it means this is a too much high water demand. So this shows clearly that this is not sustainable. And we are now trying to next paper to then what is a sustainable water subtraction scenario, how much we can produce using irrigation. Maybe we will write a paper soon. But next S3 scenario is about the use of the forest land. And then we use project team member Ito-san's visit model, which Professor is also using. Vegetation integrated simulator for the transcanses, which actually, all ground biomass and interior and foods is modeled for carbon cycle and water cycle and nitrogen cycles. And we change this biomass replacement of natural vegetation by biofilm crops. This model. And this diagram shows the results of the assessments. So this is net primary production, NPP. This is the net carbon dioxide budget. This is NAP. And so actually, it's a different scenario have no impact to this. But this blue line is RCP 2.6 scenario, so scenario S2. Scenario S3, here we considered two types. Like Florian mentioned, we can constrain the use of forest land to avoid tropical forest, high biodiversity, and red plus place. So this is a red plus area not considered scenario. So this means huge high biomass forest is also assumed to be converted to microbe fuel. This is worst case scenario. So that is why biomass is reduced. This is but even for this case, the soil carbon stock released. But the soil erosions are same for all scenarios. So this simply means that this use of the forest is bad for soil erosion. But fire emissions doesn't change. So this is just a map showing how this climate change and biodiversity conversion case, biodiversity non-conservation case for the biomass change and soil erosion case. But anyway, looking at these results, we might see the difficulty of achieving this climate change 2-degree target is this currently achieved exceptional without impacting other SDGs like water, like system status. These are very much impacted if we do this scenario seriously. So then the next question, how to make a balance with this? And also considering all other SDGs. So this is a big research question. We don't know the answer yet. So we need to seriously study about this. So this is maybe the hot topic for the next AR6 IPCC. And the basis for this IPCC next scenario, I'd like to mention a little bit about SSP scenario. Have you heard SSP scenario? So this is a sustainable
know, persuade and shared social economic aspect, SSPs. There are five scenarios. So this is sustainability. This is the middle of the road. This is the regional library. So this is like kind of nationalistic movement in the world. So unfortunately, I feel that some of this SSP three scenarios are now real. But this is a kind of globalization scenario, but a deep sustainability scenario. So these are the scenario assumptions, base scenario assumptions, and then IPCC next scenario, like 2 degree or 1.5 degree is also added. This is not including the climate change mitigation and new adaptations. And then, to support the researchers to do this kind of assessment, like water assessment, like system assessment, we are creating this SSP scenario for the grid level, urban population, non-urban population, and GDPs. So this is a city population modeling. And experimentally variable distance to oceans, airport, and road, and interactions and spillover impact is considered. Global interaction is interaction among the neighborhood cities, and global interactions among the cities within strong economic connectivities, considering climate predictions. And I will not go into the detail of this, but considering these, we model this SSP 1, 2, 3, and created a gridded GDP and population scenario for three scenarios. So this is how it looks like. This is Eastern Asia SSP 1 scenario. This is two scenarios. Three scenarios. One is very distinct difference in China. And this is European scenario. So this is SSP scenario at the national level is already from the SSP scenario itself. I only downscaled to the grid using these assumptions. So this is SSP one, global population for the population. This is three. So this is GDP, GDP SSP 1, 2, 3. So it shows that this is a kind of nationalistic SSP 3 have lower GDP growth. And then our result can be compared with some scenario done by national institutes. And then the scenario is using a remote sensing based grid information, so more specially expressed, kind of crispy and sharp. But just showing the differences. But anyway, you can download this scenario from our website, GCP website, here. So you can look at the page. And I'm happy to, if you're interested in this kind of studies, to use it for your research or do this modeling work with us. Please let me know later, and I'm very happy to work with you. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for your attention.